to heaven to stay. I don't know how.
Good morning.
Maybe
bump your horn if you're able to hear me okay. Morning. I don't think that would come. I might need a little bit more on the volume. Tell them I'm not coming through.
Good morning, everybody. Bump your horns if you can hear me.
Good morning. Are we hearing? Are we coming through? Okay. We're number one. He's supposed he's supposed to have it on. Good morning. Good morning. Can you hear me? Good morning. Good morning.
Can't hear you.
Good morning. Are you hearing me okay? All right. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We're grateful to him for another day that he has allowed us and to come together. And we're especially thankful to him for blessing us on this Sunday morning that is our annual homecoming service. And before we get started, I want to share a few announcements with us that and then we will move on with the service. First of all, I want to continue to encourage us to remember all of our members that are sick and shut in. Remember our elderly members that may not be necessarily sick, but footsteps are not as active as they used to be, but continue to remember them in prayer. We want to give a hearty praise to the Lord this morning for our receiving our certificate of occupancy for our building. And we are grateful to the Lord, amen, for that blessing. And we are, as we think about faith being the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen, that we are in that reality of faith coming to fruition this morning, that what we have long hoped for that is standing before us and on the inside, that those areas have been completed. Few other touch-ups that we want to do because of the pandemic. We are able to occupy the building, but because of the pandemic, we haven't made a decision yet to go back into the building. But we thank you so much, and we want to thank all of our brothers and sisters that volunteered along the way to help us to be able to arrive at that point. And again, this point, and again, we give glory and honor to the Lord. I want to thank you for those who have already gotten out and cast your vote, and a big thank you to those who will go and do that. Please go and encourage others, help others if you're able to be able to do that. We give thanks today to Deacon Whitfield and members of our hospitality group. They are busy under the shelter making preparation for us to have some takeout plates today, and want to extend a special thanks to one of our senior members, Sister Irene Whitfield. I know that she's been working behind the scenes in helping Brother Whitfield and the other members of hospitality to put this together. And so we are grateful for her, grateful for all of them who are laboring, and we pray that we'll be able to enjoy it as the day goes on. They will give directions at the end of the service, and so that we'll know how to proceed, how they want to serve. And above all, ask that you would keep your mask on, maintain your social distances, and they will give further direction at that time. Thank you for your attention. At this time, Reverend Royster is going to come and lead us in our call to worship and our invocational prayer. And afterwards, Brother Patrick will lead us in a selection, and we'll come back and share the message with you for the day.
Morning, St. John. We want to thank you for being able to come out again today for our annual homecoming service, and we hope that you will enjoy the service today, and we're going to move it right along so that we'll be able to get all of that good food for the day after the message that Reverend Scott will bring. The psalmist says, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, and unto his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name." May we pray. Lord, we thank you again for blessing and keeping us up until this point. And even though we are in a pandemic, you continue to bless in a mighty way. We just thank you for who you are and what you are doing for us. We pray thy blessings upon the people throughout the land, wherever they are, and whatever situation they may be in. We just pray thy blessings upon them. We ask a special blessing today for our pastor as he brings forth the word. We pray that it will lift someone's spirits today as they leave this place. We pray for all of those that came from far and near, and we pray traveling grace and mercy as they depart from this place today. Be thankful unto the Lord, the psalmist says, and we thank him today for his goodness and his loving kindness and his mercy. In Jesus' name that we pray, amen. Brother Patrick will lead us in our opening selection.
Thank you.
Let the church say amen. God is so good to all of us, and we thank and we praise him for his mighty acts, for his wonderful works, for everything that he does to sustain us from day to day, and we're mighty glad about it. Again, so thankful for the privilege this morning of being able to be back at this station and for the health and strength that the Lord continues to give. Thank you all for your continued prayers and support. Thank you for your love gifts from last Sunday. And Joyce and I certainly appreciate all that you have done and for things that are continuing to be done. And so we are just mighty glad. Know that we don't deserve all of God's goods, but we are thankful that he's a God that is merciful and kind toward all of us, even when we don't do what we are always supposed to do. Today, I want to share a word with us from Psalm 122. It's not a word that is new to us, but a word that we often repeat. From Psalm 122, the psalmist says that, "I was glad when they said to me, 'Let us go into the house of the Lord.' Our feet have been standing within your gates, O Jerusalem." Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together, where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, to the testimony of Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. For thrones are set there for judgment, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. Peace be within your walls, prosperity within your palaces. For the sake of my brethren and companions, I will now say, peace be within you. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good. Eternal God, thank you now for your word. As your word goes forth, we pray that it will find a lodging place in our hearts and in our minds, that as the days come and go, that we would use your word to glorify you, dear Lord, that others may see the light in us and glorify you as the Father and the Son. We thank you for all of these blessings and this privilege. Let your word not go out and come back void, but let it accomplish that which you desire. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. From the text here today from Psalm 122, I want to talk about how to worship during a pandemic. How to worship during a pandemic. History tells us that this song here in Psalms 122 is a song of ascent. This is one of the many songs that the Hebrews would sing as they made their journey up to Jerusalem for worship and for different festivals that God had set in place for their remembrance of their great deliverance. The psalm suggests to us that somebody had extended an invitation to come to the Lord's house for worship. We are glad today for the opportunity and the invitation to be able to come to the Lord's house for worship and fellowship. And we recognize that, especially on this homecoming Sunday, the opportunity to be able to be together again. But I want us to note that people everywhere have a long-standing invitation. Jesus declared it in Matthew 11, 28 and 29 when he said, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Sometimes we wonder what to do with ourselves when we are away from the house of the Lord. Sometimes when we are shut in or shut out, we may become idle or we may not read the word of God. We may forget the Lord. We may stray from his commandments. We may not pray and we may not always follow through with what we are supposed to do. But I believe that the psalmist gives us a solution to us in this psalm of what to do with ourselves when we are shut out from our regular assemblies. It's how to worship 101, if you will, under COVID-19 circumstances or the other difficulties that we may incur in life. Three things that I notice here that the writer had fixed in his mind. First of all, that he knew what he was glad about. Secondly, he knew where he wanted to go, even though he wasn't there. Thirdly, he knew what he wanted to do when he arrived at the house of the Lord. As we look at the text and we recognize that the writer knew what that he was glad about. He knew that, and he had his mind set on what he was glad about, and that was about going to the house of the Lord. Going up to Jerusalem, the place that he had been able to go to and to be able to meet God there. And when we are shut out from the house of the Lord, it tells us that we ought to have some thought in mind about God's house and how that we have enjoyed in days gone by, and it will help motivate us in the times in which we live. When we look at the text in the writer's mind, there stood the temple that he was just imagining in his mind. The holy city, and as he looks at it, that he's reminded that this is a symbol of worship, that it symbolizes the people's unity in the Lord. It symbolizes our coming together with the Lord and finding that one common goal, that element of unity as we are only able to find in him. The writer expresses a devout desire to know God, to accept the invitation to know God for himself. And we, my brothers and sisters, that when we are shut out, we must hear the appeal from 1 John 5:21, where he says, "Little children, keep yourselves from idols." Amen. We have to be careful about the wrong things that try to enter our mind when we are shut out. It's like being away from home sometimes, that when we get out from under our parents' sight, that sometimes we want to do what we want to do. But we must learn to remember our home training and remember what we have been taught. And likewise, when we are out from the Lord's house, we must remember what we have been taught so that we might conduct ourselves and represent our God in a way that he would be pleased with. The psalmist here saw the opportunity to not only meet with God, but the opportunity to be drawn together with other people in spiritual worship as he would enter and think about the temple. Today we are glad for the opportunity to gather outside here on our campus. So thankful for that, but we, like the psalmist, hold out a hope for the day when we can again rejoice on the inside of the building. We hold out hope like Jeremiah in chapter 31 of Jeremiah's word there, when he prophesied to the people of God in their captivity. The Lord said, "I will build you up again, and you, virgin Israel, will be rebuilt. Again, you will take up your timbrels and go out to dance with the joyful." There will be a day when watchmen cry out in the hills of Ephraim, "Come, let us go up to Zion, to the Lord our God." We hold out this hope that sometime in the future that we can return to our sanctuary and we can rejoice more fervently in the Lord. But for right now, for today, for this morning, for this homecoming service, the Lord wants us to rejoice where we are and under these circumstances, because his Spirit is available to us wherever we are. Paul said that we are to give thanks in all of our situations, that this is the will of the Lord concerning you. So we rejoice in that right now. We thank Jesus right now because he promised never to leave us nor to forsake us. And so we rejoice under the circumstances and in the circumstances because he's an ever-present help for us in our time of trouble. Anybody out there had any troubles in life and know that the Lord has been with you, that he's an ever-present help to help you over the hills and through the valleys of life. He's been mighty good, my brothers and sisters. Ron Owens, in his book, Return to Worship, says that when a correct view of God was restored to the people, their worship would be reflected in the way they lived. Worship cannot be separated from life. What are you glad about today? Are you glad to be in the number one more time? Are you glad the Lord is still keeping your mind where you can focus on him and he can be reflected in your daily living? As we worship him, he becomes more and more alive. As we seek to get to know him, we understand better his will for our lives, for our daily living. The second thing I want us to note here is that as the psalmist knew what he was glad about, secondly, he knew where he wanted to go. He had his gaze fixed on Jerusalem, the house of the Lord, the place where their feet have been standing. He knew what he was glad about. We ought to know today the things that we are glad about, my brothers and sisters, that we are glad about the opportunity to be able to just say a word, to be able to give a word to somebody that is down and out. When we look at our situation, that we are not the first ones to have to be away from the house of the Lord. The psalmist here gives us the example. He rejoices at the thought of the invitation to be able to just come to worship. He rejoices at the thought of being able to ascend up the hill to Jerusalem one more time as his place of worship. I looked at the other day as I was doing my prayer walk through the sanctuary, and I looked around and I saw that the pulpit was empty. And there were no choir members in the choir loft, no musicians at the instruments, and no people in the pews. But I did notice that the instruments were in place. The hymn books and the Bible and the offering envelopes were in the pew pockets, but there were no worshipers. The sanctuary was ready, but the circumstances have kept us from entering. Oh, the psalmist recognized that the house of the Lord was ready, but his circumstances had kept him from entering. But because it kept the psalmist from the entering the house of worship, he recognized that he could still worship where he was at. Oh, my brothers and sisters, we need not let the devil or anything else keep us from worshiping where we're at. The psalmist wants us to know that trouble didn't keep him from worship. The pandemic has kept us from the house of the Lord, but it hasn't kept us from worshiping if we are worshiped privately with him. Don't let it keep you from worshiping, my brothers and sisters, because our God is worthy of praise every day, wherever we find ourselves. We ought to be witness for him all the time. Remembering the meeting place of God will help us to stay focused when we are not able to be in his house. So here, as we look at the psalmist who knew what he was glad about and knew where he wanted to go, he also knew what he wanted to do when he arrived there. He was fixed on prayer for the people, prayer for Jerusalem, prayer for the nation. And we ought to be fixed on prayer for our neighbors, my brothers and sisters, for the nation and for other nations, that we ought to be fixed on asking God, because God is the great fixer. He's the one that is able to straighten out whatever our situations are, whether they be great or small. The question was asked in Jeremiah, is anything too hard for the Lord? Whatever you're going through today, my brothers and sisters, let me tell you that it's not too hard for the Lord. And so as the psalmist begins to stay fixed on prayer, he begins to stay fixed on going to the house of the Lord, that he recognizes that he can worship the Lord on the outside, but it's still something about being able to gather together with those on the inside, that we might be able to find a word of encouragement, that we might be able to hear somebody testify as to how good the God has been in their lives. Years ago, the authors of the Interpreter's Bible Commentary, in their comments about worship and being the house of the Lord, they said that when the place of prayer is forsaken, psychological clinics are overcrowded, the pew is empty, and suicide is common. There is no time for meditation. Frenzy begins to take the place of pause. The effects are seen in art and in music, in journalism, and extravagance and sensationalism. Impatience intrude into every sphere of life till minds become jaded and tempers become frayed and energy becomes exhausted. Fidelity in marriage and happiness in domestic life in such an atmosphere becomes increasingly difficult. divorce becomes the easy way out. If men have nothing to lift their thoughts to the supreme heights, nothing to appeal to their deeper selves or their souls, nothing to help them see life in perspective, they will become miserable introverts, a torment to themselves and a problem to their friends. It is true, my brothers and sisters, that worship of God, it keeps sanctity and peace in our minds. Is this not our surroundings when we look at it today? Is this not our nation, our world? The peace of the nation was a prayer on the psalmist's mind. I need to ask us today, what's on your mind? Do you have peace, or do you have disturbing the peace on your mind today? The psalmist knew what he wanted to do when he got to the house of the Lord. He wanted to pray for Jerusalem. He wanted to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We ought to want to pray for peace among us, peace for our neighbors, peace for our nation, peace for our world. Just as we return home ever so often, my brothers and sisters, to renew and strengthen the ties that bind us, the same is true of returning to the house of the Lord. We return so that our ties to the brotherhood and sisterhood may become stronger. Solomon, in his great wisdom, said, "A threefold cord is not easily broken." When the bond between brothers and sisters and the Lord in the middle of us produces a bond that is not easily broken. And that's how we cope with what's on the outside when we are not able to come to the Lord's house. That we remind ourselves that we are intertwined in that threefold cord with our brothers and sisters and with the Lord. And that cord is not easily broken. The psalmist here had the church on his mind, but more important, the God that would meet him at the church. He was in meditation on the way, singing on the way, but when he got to the house of the Lord, there he could finish his worship. He had a great zeal for the house of the Lord, and the zeal stationed him to worship even before he got to the house of the Lord. If you and I will reflect on the Lord when we are away, we can rejoice better when we are gathered together. The psalmist didn't have to be at church. He could start worship before he arrived at church and be able to finish up when the benediction came. And he could take what he had and begin to put it together in life and help somebody along the way. When we look at this about keeping worship and worshiping in the time of pandemic, we look at the New Testament where Jesus taught the woman at the well how to worship during times of trouble. You remember the woman at the well, a Samaritan, a biracial person, and her lifestyle didn't allow her to mingle with the people of the higher culture. But Jesus taught her how to still worship. He said in John 4, 23 and 24, "But the hour is coming and now is when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him." God is a spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. People may be shut out, but they are not cut off from the Lord, because just as the writer had it in his mind, in his spirit, to think on God, to think on Jerusalem, to pray for the welfare of Jerusalem, we too can reach out and worship God wherever we are. Can't you hear David asking God, "Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence?" David concludes that he's every and everywhere, God, for all kinds of people from everywhere and those from nowhere, that we can go to him and be able to worship him and to commune with him in the good times as well as the bad times. The hymnologist of old said, "Living below in this old sinful world, hardly a comfort can afford, striving alone to face temptation sore. Where could I go but to the Lord? Neighbors are kind, I love them everyone. We get along in sweet accord, but when my soul needs manna from above, where could I go but to the Lord?" Don't let the pandemic or the epidemics, my brothers and sisters, or the troubles in life stop you from giving praise to God. Don't let the devil steal your joy. Don't let troubles blind you to the blessings of God. Don't let sickness shut you out from the Spirit of the Lord. Don't let anything shut you out from the love of God through Christ Jesus, his Son. I don't know about you, but I'm glad today, my brothers and sisters, that we serve a God who's able to reach us wherever we are at. We are able to reach out to him, and he's able to love us and to care for us and to motivate us. So never feel left alone, because his spirit is there. He's always walking with you. All we have to do is continue to do like the psalmist, to commune with him in our thoughts and in our minds, to meditate on him, to meditate on his goodness, meditate on his house, and meditate on his son Jesus, who gave his life that we might have true life through him, that we might have eternal life. I don't know about you today, but there may be somebody in the audience that's not accepted Jesus in your life. Maybe you're struggling along on the journey, not able to cope as you think that you ought to be able to cope. I want you to recognize that there is a Savior named Jesus who died for you. He died that your sins could be forgiven. And as you receive him in the pardon of your sin, that he promised to walk along with you. He promised to be with you. And even at times when we're not able to carry ourselves, that he's able to carry us. Let me extend the invitation today, if there should be one today among us, that you would open up your hearts and that you would just pray the simple prayer of asking the Lord to forgive you of your sin and to receive you as his child. And he says that he will not turn us away. We believe on him as the Son of God, and that God has raised him from the dead. He declares that we shall be saved. If there's one today who desires to receive Jesus at home, just simply ask him to come into your heart. If there's somebody in the audience out here today, we just simply ask you to step out of your car or see us at the end of the worship service, that we will share with you the goodness of the Lord and his plan of salvation. If there should be one today, as Brother Patrick leads us in a selection, we invite you to come to Jesus while you have time.
Something that I may not know, and there are some places that I can go, but I am sure of this one thing, that my God is real, for I can feel him in my soul. If you know that he's real, come on and bunk your horns. Well, yes, God is real. He's real in my soul. Yes, God is real, for he has washed and made me whole. Well, his love for me is just like pure gold. Well, yes, God is real, for I can feel him in my soul.
And the church said, amen. God is real. We are able to feel him in our soul.
Yes,
whether we are in the house or out of the house, we are able to feel him in our soul. We're going to share now in the benediction, and afterwards we're going to ask one of the Brother Jimmy or one of the members of the hospitality group to come forward and share with us in directions about how they will serve. If you would desire to have a plate to carry home with you, we ask that you would remain and follow the directions of the group in there. Let us pray. Our wise and eternal God, we are grateful again for our gathering. We thank you for the blessings of this day. We thank you for the sunshine and the warmth that we are beginning to feel today, Lord. And we just praise your name for just letting us have this experience together one more time. Thank you for all of our homecomers, dear Lord. as well as our regular members. We praise you much and mightily that they thought enough to come to St. John again, the gathering place in this community for us, dear Lord. And we thank you for that. And we ask now, dear Lord, that you would bless the food that has been prepared. Pray for those who have prepared it. And we pray that your blessings would be upon us as we partake of it, dear Lord, that it would nourish our bodies, that it would not bring any harm to us, dear Lord, that you would just continue to bless it, bless the efforts that have been put forth on this day to make this possible. We thank you because we know that had it not been for your preparing the bountifulness of it from the earth for us, that we would not be blessed to have it. And so we give you glory and honor. We pray now, dear Lord, that your love and your grace